And I know some of you guys, by the way, I feel for you and what COVID did to your industry over last year. We hope it's coming back this end of this year. And so some of you may be going through a rebuild this summer. And who do you want on your team? I think it's probably a great time to refresh the cultural definition of your company and go and look to hire people that are going to fit. Because if they do, your job of managing is going to be a lot easier. And where they when they interact with your customers, they're going to act much more like you would act. And they're going to make decisions the way you would make decisions. So that's why it matters to have imagery and costumes and music. I used to start my town halls with this song that we picked as our theme song for our culture. And I knew I was onto something when my team came to me with this. So this was not my initiative. My team came and said, Will, we think we should have a process, a workflow for how we interact with customers. Oh my God, how beautiful is that? I said, tell me what that would look like. This is what they came up with. They came up with this goal. I hope you can read the screen. They came up with these kind of behaviors to support this idea of how we interact with clients. So powerful. And they chose Captain Client, right, as the value, the core value that they wanted to use for this particular initiative. And we do believe, you know, when we were doing this, this is also a checklist, of course. So for this client, you know, did we deliver the success we promised? Check. What one more thing can we provide? This is the team coming up with. They're making work for themselves. What one more thing can we provide? This was a game changer for me because now I wasn't having to do all the work. The team was starting to do this for me. It was huge. But I sold that company and then I had some time on my hands and my friend started saying, hey, Will, would you come and look at my culture? This guy, David, said, Will, I don't like the way it feels in my own company anymore. I don't like some of the people we're working with. I have a feeling of anxiety when I step into the office. How awful is that? His own company. So we implemented, you know, a lot of things I'm going to be talking about here in terms of making that, you know, and now he's kind of a spokesperson for culture and for leading with culture. This is what we began with, right? A few words on a piece of paper. He emailed us out at some point and thought his job was done, but none of his employees could tell you the core values, you know, more than they could remember their aunt's name. So this is what we started with. This is what we came up with. So we put some effort into wordsmithing the values, and we did that by doing surveys and interviews. And by the way, those surveys, I'm making those available to you guys if you want to run this by with your employees. Feel free to tap into my surveys. There are links and emails and things to request that in the document we're going to share at the end. So we cared about the words. We cared about the images. I helped them get excited and re-energized about what they were doing. One of the owners in the company, it's a sibling-owned company. She was a CFO, and she didn't like the fact that their product, pepper spray, hurt people. But when I started diving into what they were really all about, I realized that they're actually about saving lives and protecting people. So when we finished up down here with Go the Extra Mile, what do we mean by that in this company? We care and we do whatever it takes. We save lives. Of course, we did other things, but this really changed the company and the way they talked about things. They also came up with a theme song. Could you hear this music?
Yes.
Oh, I didn't notice anybody dancing. That was all. So that's how he gets.
Oh, we lost you.
Will, unmute.
You're muted, Will.
How about that? Sorry, guys. I got so excited I hit the mute button.
It's all that dancing. That's what it was.
Yeah. So look, this is how they run the business, right? This is their core workflows. But we intersperse the values in here too. So proud and passionate, empowered, prepared and engaged. And then we came up with their why, their core purpose. We will protect and save, and we put a number on it, 70 million lives by 2021. So now in one graphic, the employees have all the big questions answered. How do we work together? There's your values. There's the core process. What are we trying to do here? We're trying to save 70 million lives by 2021. When are we trying to do it? Why are we doing it? The big questions are all answered. And I think this, as leaders, it's really powerful if we can help our employees have all of this at their fingertips, on the walls. When we hire, this is who we are and how we go about it. And this company is, of course, they did other things well as well, but this fundamentally changed their thinking to lead with culture first and let the other things then fall into place. So I'm kind of still telling my story, right? How do I end up doing this? Well, it was very exciting for me when I realized that I'm helping companies put values on the walls now, which is kind of like rules, right? Kind of like rules, or sort of like the constitution for the US, you know, how do we want to work together? And I realized that when I was a little boy, I used to love building clubhouses. This is a 4-ton stilts, but I built other things too. But whenever I finished them, what's missing here? But, you know, so I'd build my treehouse, I'd get in there. I'd want to share it with people, right? I want to enjoy it with people. But I cared about the experience they were going to have there. I didn't want them to come here and trash it or you know, be mean to me or to each other and sort of spoil the feeling that I had. And it's really a feeling. That's what culture is. It's a feeling. And how much do we care about the way people feel when they're working with us? And I remembered how I used to put rules, I'd nail a little piece of paper with some rules on the side and invite my friends in and say to them, I'm glad you're here, but in my 8-year-old, you know, way. And, but listen, it's important to me that we follow these rules. These are the clubhouse rules. Now, why am I telling you this story? Well, I think if there's nothing else you take away from today's presentation, I hope you'll remember this. I believe it's one of the single most powerful and underutilized things that we can do in our company. It costs very little, costs nothing really, but it's very powerful, is the words, we all agreed. So when I used to do this with my friends, and as soon as they weren't being nice to each other, I would say, hey, excuse me, we all agreed to be nice to each other. There's no argument. I'm not being bossy. I'm just calling on a kind of a verbal contract that we made. And I didn't used to get pushback. Sorry, Will, you know, and on we'd go. It's the same with core values. And I believe the most junior person in the company can be empowered to call out the CEO and owner, you guys of the company, if you've done your job nicely and say, hey, you know, Matthew or Aaron or Janine, Harold, that didn't feel like respect to me. The way you just spoke to me didn't feel like respect. And isn't point to the wall, isn't one of our core values respect? Now, you may not appreciate that challenge, but I promise you the value of that person being empowered to challenge you and express feelings based on the agreed core values is a very powerful cultural, you know, nod that will pay you big dividends, because they're also going to be correcting other people when they are not acting in accordance with the values and the behaviors that you yourself have said you want to keep alive here. Any questions? Anybody think I'm crazy? This is the first set of core values I wrote in 2001 for my first company. It's a SaaS-based company. And I just want to say, I would never write core values like this again. My older, more experienced self realizes that, you know, words like integrity and respect and commitment are the ones that everybody has. And I think it's helpful to have something unique that we can really feel and latch onto that a description in our company. And also it's too wordy. How do I expect my people to remember all this? You know, so I do it differently now. And this is an example. This guy, this is how we started. This is very typical. This is what most of us have. Who's got core values that look a bit like this? Don't be shy. It's okay. Anybody's core values look like that? The basic text on a piece of paper? Well, what if they looked like, oh, am I going backwards now? What happened? This is what we ended up with for that company. And this has transformed the way they feel about their own company. They thought their job was spreadsheets and numbers and taking in money from investors and lending it out to borrowers so they can flip homes in Indianapolis. When we got into it, and we now have, so now the relationships hopefully, the core values hopefully stand out, relationships through growth. We have a we statement. That's a great thing to put on your core value poster, by the way. We, it's like that contractual commitment, we promise. An icon like this, picture tells 1,000 words, helps you remember what the value is. And of course, this image here, what does this image mean? And what do these words down here mean? Well, I'm going to come on to that here, but this sort of Zen-like balance, when we're going through the work, we realize that they're kind of, like I said, they take in from investors and they lend. So the more they can, investors they get, the more they can lend, and that's how they grow. But what are they doing? You know, in terms of their why, putting words to their why, it was really a very enlightening moment that got the CEO, who was frankly a little bit bored of his company after 10 years, it got him re-engaged, was when he realized he's not just numbers on a spreadsheet, not just trying to give a 10% return in 3 months to his investors. He's actually doing something much more meaningful. And I believe your employees all want to believe they're doing something meaningful. And if you can put words to a why that gets them jazzed about why they are building that booth for that exhibition in Las Vegas in September, or why that conversation is so important with a customer who steps into that booth for your client. And that's probably where the why is. It's not about your company growing to 10 million or whatever. It's going to be about the engaging why is going to be about something that makes people feel good, because they're doing something meaningful for the world. So it's probably not about you. It's not about your company. It's about your customer or your customer's customer. So ask yourself why, and come up with something that's meaningful. And what we realized is that, what we came up with for them is that their core purpose, their why, is to create a lasting legacy of security and freedom. For there, if you look up here, for 500 families and over 2,000 souls in the neighborhood of Central Indiana. And you can see some other numbers here, but this realization that why do people want to invest? Oh, because they want to create a lasting legacy of security and freedom. They hope this is going to help them retire, for example. Why do people borrow from this company? Well, they borrow to flip homes. Why? So that they can be entrepreneurs and have their own job, freedom. Not show up, for a paycheck at 9 o'clock. Also for financial reasons, for security. Why do people want to buy the home? Because it's their castle. They want to feel secure. So some of you are probably thinking, oh, phooey, this touchy-feely guy, hug it out. Oh, by the way, today, do you know what today is? It's National
Hugging Day.
Hugging Day, it is. Who said that?
I did. I saw it on
Ross. Okay. Yeah. It's National Hugging Day. And so I know we've got COVID and all that, but if you can with a loved one, I encourage you to hug heart to heart. It's the opposite grasp from the one we normally do. And if you hug heart to heart, there is a certain special energy around that connection. Try it out on National Hug Day. But COVID aside and all that. So does this matter? Well, let me give you a little story. So about 3 months after doing this, before the ink was even dry on this poster, Constantine thought he would try this out. He had a potential investor on the phone. And he said to the investor, listen, we're not just going to give you a return on your money, right? You're going to get that. What we're doing here at CPL Investments is we're creating a lasting legacy of security and freedom for the people that invest in us, the people that borrow from us, the people that live in the homes that we fix up. And this guy said, perfect, sign me up. I've just spoken to two other financial companies and they told me how they could give me the highest returns and they've been doing this for the most years and all that stuff. You just connected with me. That's why I want to do it. I want to drive by that corner in my neighborhood and see that somebody has fixed up a home for a family. And I want to make money, but that makes me feel good, you know? It matters. If you can get your words down on all this stuff and start to use it every day in your language with your employees, your customers, your vendors, it's really powerful. And by the way, I bet you, you've all got vendors and customers. Ask yourself, the pain in the ass vendors and the pain in the ass customers, line them up against your core values. And I bet you they score low against your core values. Your most profitable customers, your best vendors will score high on your core values. What if you could get everybody like that in all your stakeholders aligning with your culture? You're not just leading a company, you're leading a culture. It goes beyond the four walls. Your employees walk home with that at night. And get this all, you know, singing and working well together, you'll have a lot of fun with it. Which is a great point, by the way. This is also fun, this work. It's creative. And you get people talking about what matters to them. Maybe core values look like this. This is a CPA firm in Michigan. What if they look like this? Where the imagery of the horse here conveys this idea of we serve. And, you know, again, how does this work? Why does it matter why does it help to have graphics to help emote your values? Well, I love this from Robert Horn at Stanford. Look at this. When words and visual elements are closely intertwined, we create something new and augment our communal intelligence. Does that sound good? Would you all like that? To augment your communal intelligence? Yeah, come on, that would be great. Mm-hmm. And visual language has the potential for increasing human bandwidth, the capacity, et cetera, et cetera. This was the moment that got Ross, right, Ross?
Light bulb, it went off.
The light bulb went on. Thank you. Okay, I don't know if you need more examples, but here was a story. Those were his values. He did have them on his walls like that. His employees walked by them every day on his conference room. This is a construction company. Stop these guys in the hallway, ask them, hey, what are our core values? Even though they walk by them every day, nobody could mention all four. None of his employees could mention all four. Some of them were getting one or two. So what's the process? Take your core values, here they are, collaboration, awareness, add some descriptive behaviors to them that help explain what do we mean by those values in our company. Really think about, so the company, this company's name is Emergent, think about who you are, where you come from, what's important to you, you know, those kinds of things. Then you can throw it out for crowdsourcing on ideas for what the images could look like to go with those core values. And maybe you end up with something like this, where he's got collaboration tied in with roots, heart to the soil, integrity about, think about the strong tree trunk representing integrity. This imagery helped him develop the culture that he wanted. And he refers to this when he does his huddle each day before his teams go out and do their construction. So that's the values. And again, coming back to purpose, well, here's a research by Mercer showing the importance of purpose and that your employees are three times more likely to stay with you if you have a strong sense of purpose. Here's Gallup putting it as one of the five. Unfortunately, they put it last. I wish it was first. But if you want your employees to thrive, giving them purpose is one of those things that will help them thrive. And in this case, he came up with core purpose being, you know, he wants to help not just build kitchens for people, but help them feel more connected, build meaningful memories, and live their best lives. Now, some of you guys, you're building stuff, right? Some of you are at least in the design and construction of exhibition stuff, right? Yeah. Do this if you agree. Thank you. Thank you, Matthew. And Doug. Again, just to tell a story about, so Matthew Troyer, who owns this company, what do we do when we want a kitchen done? We get three quotes, don't we? So two quotes come in and, you know, beautiful pictures, shiny granite, glistening stainless steel, you know, we're going to transform your kitchen, $40,000, 6 months, you know, that's the stuff that most people quote. When Matthew, when he is going into his clients now, yes, he's saying, look, there's a lot of people that can build you a great kitchen in Indianapolis. But when we build your kitchen, which is going to look beautiful, it's going to have beautiful shiny granite, glistening stainless steel. But from start to finish, we are going to be thinking about how this space is going to be used by you and your family. And we're going to work with you to build a space such that you feel more connected with your family and neighbors. And maybe make meaningful memories with your family and neighbors stood around this kitchen. And we think of it as a springboard for you to go live your best lives. Does that sound like something that someone that you would like to partner with on your new kitchen project? Of course, they're going to say, yeah. And you're $10,000 more, but that's okay because we get it. That's why we're doing this, you know? So it matters, it works. And if I can help any of you, by the way, go through this process of talking about this or getting there, I'm available to you. Just email me. What happens when it goes wrong? Well, who knows the Wells Fargo story? The Wells Fargo scandal? Yes, yes, a number of you do. Okay. Well, so of course, you know how it ended, right? This guy got fired. He did jail time. They were fined $1 billion. They were actually, screwing their customers by making them open more accounts, sometimes without them knowing, opening credit card accounts and all that. Why? Because they were incentivized to do that pressured to do that by the bank. But what do you think their core values said? Their core values said, we will never do anything to hurt our customers' credit. We are full of integrity, you know, the most glowing, flowery, beautiful core values that a bank could ever write. You would want to be with this bank based on their core values. But had you been, you would have had all these accounts open for you and all that bad stuff happened. So my point is, whatever you say, that spotlight that you put on yourself around your values, please step into that spotlight and be the leader that you say you are. This is what happened when I was doing my research. I came across this for Wells Fargo. How would you feel if somebody took your brand and did this to your brand? Or, you know, some disgruntled person hung this flag from one of your booths at the largest concrete show, you know, of the year. That's how easy it is these days, a tweet for somebody to mess with your brand and your image. And look, I don't think it's hard. I think have great values, make sure they really are, describe you and your company, and live true to them. And you will sleep better at night. I think about that CEO, that guy, he's a father. What do his kids think about him? you know, he chased shareholder value, and for a while it worked. But now their image is tarnished. This bank, by the way, had a very fine reputation until that happened. And Riot Games is another one, and I just won't tell the whole story, but I love this because there's the sign. Be the company you say you are. They, again, had glowing core values, but stomped all over their own core values. You perhaps remember the Boeing story. The planes that crashed and the corners that they cut around safety and hoodwinking the FAA and stuff like that. Well, whenever this happens, whenever I hear a corporate scandal now and they happen all every day, I think, ooh, I wonder what their core values say. And sure enough, look at this, what Boeing said. When it comes to safety, there are no competing priorities. Well, you lying sons of dogs. That's not true. You actually did compromise safety for competing priorities like budget and stuff like that. And you know how that story went down. Who's responsible for allowing Boeing to be, again, their image to be tarnished? And they say the right things, they just weren't doing them. What's the difference? Who's responsible? Don't you think the CEO, it starts with the leader? Yeah, I think so. The leader, every day, his top 100 people in that company, if every day he was saying, these are our values, this is how we operate, I believe they would not. They would have made a safe plane that, by the way, instead of being grounded for the last 2 years, would be flying passengers safely all over the world and would still be saying, if it's not Boeing, I'm not going. But now people are buying Airbus. And what about this story? Minneapolis Police Department. Look at these values. You can read them there in front of you, hopefully. Straight off their website. Look at the last bullet point. We do not engage in conduct, public or private, that would sully or shame the department. And look what is on their vehicle door. To serve with compassion. So every day police officers are opening that door. I think that's a value. And I think if the police chief every day and every week was saying, this is who we are, these are our values, and was unhiring people that do not fit these values and hiring people that do fit these values, then I think that the story would, for George Floyd, would have ended differently. Because look, I think the ones that stood around watching would have felt more empowered by the values and by what the leadership was saying to do the right thing. We can do a lot with values in our company, and it doesn't cost much. When it's done right, I think Starbucks is an interesting example, because on that same kind of thing, they've had their own scandals, but how did they handle them? Scandal of African-Americans being disrespected, basically, in the space where they say their value is creating a culture of warmth and belonging where everyone is welcome. Everyone is welcome. When that scandal happened, Starbucks closed every store for a whole day for training on, and really it's part of their values. What did that cost them, right? A lot of money. The other side of that spectrum is some Starbucks employees also refused to serve uniformed police officers. But wait, Starbucks culture is creating a culture of warmth and belonging where everyone is welcome. They weren't taking sides here. They weren't taking sides, Black Lives Matter or Back the Badge. That's their values. What did they do? They started a Coffee with a Cop program nationwide, and they started reaching out to police departments that had been ill-treated, and they terminated the employees that had ill-treated them. Same as they did when African Americans were badly treated. That will stand the test of time. That, I believe, will maintain their share price, their reputation, as long as somebody doesn't come along and and stop, you know, acting true to them. Southwest Airlines is another good example. Okay. Why does all this matter? Hopefully I've given you some reasons why it matters and how you can, with very simply, actually, with very little money, create a culture. And it's not just about poster on the wall, it's what you do after that. You've got to help people talk about it. But what it starts to do is it starts to show people that you care about the way they feel at work. And I like to say that strategy is to thought as culture is to feelings. And if you're all strategy and all thought and not caring about the way people feel, you're not tapping who we are to be human. So I think, you know, we're gonna see a lot in this decade. I'm calling it the feeling decade. I think we're putting stakeholder value first and then shareholder value will follow. And employees and customers and everyone's going to vote with their feet and their wallet as to who they are allied with. Yes. Oh, hopefully this is not true in your company, but there is plenty of research to show that for every engaged employee, there are two disengaged employees. Every year, it's the same ratio. Worldwide, hopefully it's better in our smaller, more manageable companies, but imagine the return on investment, the return on culture, if you can flip that ratio to have two engaged employees for every, globally, what could we do? Okay. A little bit of COVID and I'm getting towards being done here. I don't think, if you're doing a great job managing culture, I don't think it matters whether your company is all, of course, a lot of your team is dispersed, you know, as part of their job, they do that. So you're already used to kind of managing remotely. But this slide is in the deck, I'm running short of time, so you can get that there or hit me up with questions if you're particularly interested in that. And I am excited for some of you guys as you start maybe rebuilding and rehiring. Defining the culture you always dreamt of for your company, and then going and hiring people that are going to fit that. If you're not sure how to do that, please reach out. But there are lots of benefits to having culture. Here is the link to the resources. I think somebody, perhaps Ross, you can put that in the chat for everybody. The link, and on this doc here, I'm looking at the sort of right-hand panel here. There are my surveys, my workbooks, you know, all that stuff. Dive in. If there's anything's not clear, there's also a PDF. You can download a PDF copy of the book, The Culture Fix, which you can see over here on the left. And yeah, I'd love to think that you guys got something out of this and can, you know, make a difference for your company. This visual summarizes the book, which basically I've covered in this presentation. So there we go. You didn't interrupt me with questions, but I know you're going to hit me with them now. What do you think, Nancy? Oh, Nancy, what do you think? Anything of value here? Or Aaron?
Yeah, I definitely think there's definite value.
Cool, thank you.
My company does have core values. They are not set up exactly this way, but it's definitely something to bring back because I really like the way these are set up. It's just more engaging. In fact, I was texting my boss telling her that this was happening because she wasn't able to be on it. So I really liked it.
Thank you. I apologize for picking on you, but
it's fine. No, I went away so I could see it on a bigger screen. So I put my camera down, so that's why I turned my
camera
off.
Well, I think this is a great opportunity for you, Nancy, perhaps for others. So you have values, but you know, you haven't been working together much, have you, lately? At least a number of your companies haven't. So this could be an interesting way to re-engage, you know, your core team of employees, is to get them involved in taking the core values to the next level. adding graphics, you know, getting them up on the wall, teaching, training people how to talk about them. Yes. Thank you, Nancy.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Matthew.
So this was many years ago in a career, several before this one. I worked for GE Capital, and we had 10 core values. And what they did was, one of them was like integrity and efficiency. And they emphasized one value each month and recognized an employee who exemplified that value. Now, I don't work at a company. We don't have enough, you know, full-time employees, even before COVID, that would be an efficient thing. But for a larger, you know, one of the larger companies, you know, bigger shop with a lot of employees, that might be what it was. And you, I mean, they would give you it wasn't an expensive watch, but you got a watch and it said, you know, Value Club on it. And then you were recognized with a monetary bonus as well that you got at the end of the year. So, and it was just how they promoted the values within the company. And you're talking a Fortune 5 company. So,
yes,
they were pretty serious about it. And, you know, I was in charge of the newsletter. So we always highlighted whatever the value for that month was.
And Matthew, do you think that made a difference in the success of the company and the way people treated each other and worked together?
I think so. It also, I think it also promoted a bit of healthy competition as well, because you wanted to be a better employee because you wanted that to be recognized for being the most efficient or providing the best customer service
or having the most integrity.
Exactly. Yeah. However that resulted, you know, and it was, you could be nominated by your peers. That didn't necessarily mean that you won, but it brought that attention to the next level or the next two levels of management, who were the ones that voted on who the winner was. Yeah. And, you know, I certainly think that, you know, people, you know, I would value the integrity award over any of the other core values, because I think integrity is one of the, you know, is a key value in everyone's life. So there are certain ones. I just think, you know, it certainly goes to promoting culture.
And I bet it helped them out.
What is going on?
Boy, mute them all.
I don't think it's me.
It's Zoom recording.
Okay, I removed the Zoom recorder, whatever that was.
Nice work, so, Steve. Very decisive.
I don't know. Doug, did you let them in from the? Was that you let them in from the waiting room? Probably, right?
I did. I didn't realize it at the time.
Oh, sorry. I'm just kidding. Yeah, I think that was somebody that was like.
We got bombed.
Hacked type thing. Yeah.
Well, there are four people in the waiting room right now. By the way, I don't know if they're genuine or not, but.
I don't think so. We just, all those just flurried in like that, like just a whole bunch of them came in at once.
Yeah, I don't recognize any of those names.
So they're bombing, as you say.
It's called.
Wow.
So crazy. Now I know the value of a waiting room. That's why Zoom make us do that.
Yep.
Yep.
Yeah.
I think that having core values like that, even in a small company, I think it's beneficial for, you know, the value of, you know, of what the employees and engaging the employees. So
yeah, here we go again. What was that?
Wow.
Well, I have a question.
Yeah.
So with all the furloughs that are going on, I know this is a issue that all sorts of companies of every different size or industry is dealing with. For those employees that have had to be furloughed, I mean, when companies say things, and I know that we all mean it, sincerely, we care about you as a person, you're part of our work family and so forth. Well, even though people understand there's a reduction in business and resources and cash and you have to furlough people, there's still got to be some bent feelings when that happens. And I know that again, companies large and small, even when people are furloughed, they want to stay in touch with them. And a lot of companies do a great job of that. What's your suggestions for company owners that have to deal with a furlough issue and letting people know they're valued while they're on furlough? And you know, again, in the back of their mind, you have to think that they're wondering, why me?
Yes. Yes. So after the fact, it's hard, but I do think, again, core values can help. So if you've really got core values set and a strong culture before you face that furloughing event, I think using them to power that conversation with the individual or individuals is really, really helpful, because you can't, a bit like the US Constitution, you can't really argue against core values. If they're aligned and you've been talking about them for a year through the good times, then the bad times come, you use them to for those conversations too. And so I think they do help that genuine, authentic conversation that perhaps when you want to bring those folks back, you know, there is still a relationship such that allows you to do that. So it just helps a lot if you've had them established, you know, before you hit that painful event. But using them and in that moment, I think, is very powerful. And I've done that to unhire people. Basically, you have the core values. If someone's not fitting your culture, and it's a great idea to rank people on the core values. If you've got 10 employees, you put them down the left-hand side of your spreadsheet. You've got 5 values. They go across the columns. Just give people a score of 1 through 3. And the people with the top score, you know, are your A players. But you might be surprised to see, oh, there's 1 or 2 people at the bottom there who are scoring really low against my core values. And you've been kind of walking by them every day, but not really facing up to that. That little simple scoring mechanism suddenly shows you how far away they are from your top employees. So then what do you do? Well, I suggest you respectfully unhire them. If they're really a low score, you can't coach them to be great employees. If they're kind of close or in the middle ranking, you can. But if they're really down the bottom there, unhire them. The first thing you're going to get from the rest of your team is a thank goodness we finally took care of that person. You know, got them out of here. Doesn't this feel better? You know, but also I think if you sit with them and say, listen, and I like to use the term unhired because fired make it sounds like it's all their fault, which it isn't. We hired them. So I like to think of unhiring, more of an uncoupling. And so you bring them in, you both sit at the same side of the table, opposite the core values or you know, poster on the wall. And you say, look, you know, it's clear that things aren't going great. Let's just look at the people that succeed here. And you go down the values, you know, respect, teamwork, and all that sort of thing. Teamwork's huge. Everybody that collaborates here gets on great. You know, do you feel like you're one of those people, or are you perhaps, you know, better, you know, being a solopreneur or being, you know, are you more of a lone cowboy? We had this in the software world a lot. Folks that just are lone cowboys, like, the, you know, knock it out, but really bad at working in a team. That didn't work for us. And of course, you get people agreeing. Yeah, you're right. Yeah. You know, and I've had people say, maybe I should look for a job somewhere else. And I bite their hand off. Yes, you are right. You know, and we'll help you do that. We'll give you 30 days. Please go, please. I mean, we'll give you as much time as you want to go look for your next job, which is going to be a better fit for you and frankly, work better for the team. It's a really lovely way to unhire somebody, you know? I think hopefully that answers your question, Dave. And I appreciate the thought.
It does. And this has been a great presentation. I've really enjoyed it.
Thank you, Dave.
I've only been unhired twice in my life. Wait, twice I've been unhired.
Yeah. me too, by the way. Yeah. Didn't feel great. Steve, I feel like you're playing defense right now. Are you keeping the wolves from the door?
Yeah, I've had to, there's like a bunch of people trying to get in. So I deleted them and I sent a report to Zoom on them. So because they weren't people that signed up, because I'd recognize the names of people signed up. So.
Yeah.
Sorry, I never had that happen before.
Yeah.
It was weird that somebody tried to get in, but I was like, I didn't think that would happen.
Yeah, who wants to come to the EDPA Southern California meeting?
Yeah, you hear stories about, you know, high school, the kids getting people sticking in and that sort of thing. I've never seen that on a Zoom meeting, though.
Are any of you guys face, just cut me off when you're ready, Steve, but are any of you guys, you know, thinking about this summer, you know, getting ready to go back to work and therefore going to go through some hiring again?
I'm just praying that, being one of the last people standing, that there's going to be opportunity.
Yeah. Yeah. That's the first thing, right? We can't do anything until we book some shows.
For us, the majority of our people, we expect that when we have work that they'll all be back.
Great.
We're a labor company, so we set up exhibits and our managers are all, you know, laid off and doing whatever projects and stuff that they can. But at the moment, 90% of them, we've only lost one out of all of them, so they're coming back in our core team as well. So
okay, and are you staying in touch with them, Matthew, and maintaining a relationship?
Yeah, we have monthly Zooms with all of our furloughed or laid off managers, and just, you know, hey, what are you guys doing? What's happening with everybody? And, you know, this is what we're doing at the corporate office, or, you know, all that kind of stuff. What projects that, you know, what have you been doing with your life? Just staying connected and you know, talking about, you know, filing for PPP and the plan for, you know, when stuff starts coming back, how we're going to staff stuff. And, you know, we've had conversations with other labor companies like Nancy's and that we're going to work, you know, share resources. And at the, you know, right now, our core group of guys, if one company needs a lot of workers and they can't fulfill it, then they're going to reach out to the rest of us and we'll get our guys some work to do. And it's just, you know, although we're in the big scheme of things, we're all competitors, we're also in this to save each other. And it's, you know, it's one of the core values of EDPA is community. And that's what we're here for. So.
Well, as you can probably tell, I'm a people person, and I love face-to-face. I mean, I'm ready to go back, and all this Zooming is getting old. What about you, Harold? Anything interesting here for you?
Yeah, so my situation is I'm a remote employee, so I'm not around the core group of employees. So to be honest, I'm not sure. I mean, I'm sure there is a core value poster somewhere in Portland. I don't see it every day, but I will say this. I've been with the organization a little over 2 years, and I'm an old guy. I've worked for a bunch of different groups. I've never worked for a group that has more esprit de corps and respect for management than where I am now. So whether it's through really good posters in Portland, or just words turning into actions. They
do a
stellar job with that. So
yeah,
I'm amazed by that every week.
Yes, so you feel you work in a great culture, and without it even needing to be defined, people are just acting that way.
Yeah, like I said, it's very possible that in Portland are well aware of it, and they talk about it, they have games about it, but since I'm not there, I connect this way for better or worse. So
Thank you.
I actually have our core values like right in front of my computer screen. We have a card, like a postcard type thing.
Yeah.
So I look at that every day. After this, I feel like they could probably up the game a little bit with them. But like Matthew said, we're the same type of company and we've been doing the same type of connections with the Zooms, and you know, 80% of our admin staff is gone, and we're hoping, you know, most of them, I don't think have moved on, but
yeah,
you know, it is tough, but we are trying to, you know, connect to them. But I do keep my core value card right in front of me, so I see it every day, all day long while I'm working.
Yeah.
So
Yeah, so it's a lovely thing, you know, it just in your conversations with your team or with customers is if that card's in front of you, just bring those words into your conversation with the employee and with them. And, you know, shout them out if you catch them committing a core value. And then it becomes language for them too. And the whole thread of your culture, you know, just starts to naturally emanate.
Well, we actually kind of laugh, almost like not make fun of each other, but like, we'll use a word from the core value and we're like, oh, I just said that. We don't even know we're saying it, but it's
there you go.
Kind of inbred in it, you know, just kind of just who we are. So that's kind of funny that you said that because we do that. So
what is one of your core values?
One of them is adapt.
Okay. And do you have some descriptive behaviors that say what you mean by adapt there?
So no, we don't. So that is something I feel like we could probably enhance a little bit better. You know, it's not on the card. It's probably.
Yeah. Let's just take that. Adapt. What a great word for you in 2020, right? So you're to furlough 80% of your admin staff, but you can make that conversation so much easier. Hey guys, one of our values is adapt. Well, look what's happened. This is the time we got to do that. I'm really sorry. But, you know, part of that, our adaption process, you know, now is going to, or our adapting is going to have to be letting some of you guys go. But listen, as soon as this turns around, we're going to be true to our value of adapt, and we are going to be hiring back and getting back to work. And I just think that's just a lot easier message than, you know, you're fired.
Right.
There. Will, you've done a fantastic job as a board member, and it's been a very uplifting meeting. I'm going to share a story that isn't perhaps so happy about core values.
Okay.
Yeah. I used to work for a company, going unnamed. Probably a few people on the board know who I'm going to refer to.
Who? GS.
No, the other one.
Freeman.
I
don't think he wants to say.
I didn't say, so it can't be used against me on LinkedIn. Who actually kind of weaponized core values.
Oh yeah, tell me about that.
Well, the core values were printed up on a nice little trifold business card, and every employee was required to carry it in their wallet or purse or briefcase. And any manager at any time could, you know, demand to see it to make sure that you were studying and were up to date on the core values. And it was weaponized to a point where managers we're using that as as the quick excuse. You know, it's like the cop looking for probable cause.
Yeah.
To punish whoever crossed them at that moment. And
Wow.
I'm a little lucky. I was unhired by that company, and went out on my own for 6-7 years. And my core values at my company are very simple, and that is under promise, overperform. Make money and don't hit your sister. It can get interesting. Core values are.
Yes, that's interesting. So clearly that's when it's kind of gone wrong, hasn't it? That's not about people feeling good, feeling safe. That is, as you say, being used as a whip or a hammer or something. And I think it's one thing to, now I have heard of people stopping people in the hallway and saying, hey, do you mind just, you know, hey, what are our core values? Like really testing, do they know them? Can they recall them? I think that's valid. I've definitely done that, but there doesn't need to be a consequence if they can't name them all. You're just trying to make sure they're aware of them. But if the consequence is, okay, I can unhire you because you didn't have your copy of your values in the briefcase.
Yes, yeah, no, yeah,
that's going a bit far.
But then again, you could probably describe me as one of your classic lone wolves. I never bought into the program as it was, or at least certainly as it was administered. And quite frankly, the imposition on the managers to administer it was painful at times.
Yeah. Yeah. Thank you.
Rob, before we end up saying goodbye to each other, I just wanted to give a shout out and some appreciation. Our industry lost one of its founding fathers yesterday, at least the portable modular side, Larry Crumlish out of Texas passed yesterday. I don't know if any of you worked with him, but being on the portable modular side of the industry, he was an icon. He hired tons of us, brought us in 35, 40 years ago, and has remained in the industry up until yesterday. So I just wanted to pass along some not only condolences to the family, but appreciation for Larry and what he brought to the industry.
Yeah.
Thank you, Harold.
Very good. Thank you.
Great. Yeah. Super interesting. And yeah, I'm glad you were able to join as well. You know, this is a really good subject. You know, our industry is pretty unique. It takes a certain type of person to do the work that we do. And in my 14 years of doing this, the one thing I've noticed is like all the people that are doing it love doing this so much. They have to, you know, and, you know, it's funny with the, with one of the other, core values before with adapt, you know, adapt is it for our industry, it's like, it happens constantly on the show floor. It's like, we're constantly having to adapt to things and you can't react and do things to make it look like there's something wrong. Cause you can't let the clients be afraid. And, you know, you always have to show control and you always have to have an answer for a solution. Cause we have to problem solve constantly. And, you know, those kind of core values can help people to be able to channel that when they are on the show floor or dealing with clients. And clients can be very finicky and very difficult, and they don't understand, like, it's not just this. You can't just change something. You can't just, oh, it's just this, you know, and how to deal with that stuff. It could be really helpful, you know. And I think, you know, the problem with these things, like with the COVID or whatever, or what we had in, was in 2008 and stuff, it's like, companies use it as a purge almost, you know, gives them a chance to let go of the people that are dead weight and stuff. And now when they're going to bring people back in, this gives them an opportunity to, like you said earlier, is to just to find those values that when they hire these people back, that if they don't fall into that category, then you know that you don't want them back in there again, because you'll have the same problems as you did last time, as opposed to just like filling bodies in a space. So I think it'll be interesting. Yeah. Will be more selective as they hire back. So it's going to take time for us to, it'll take a couple of years for the industry to bounce back. So nobody will be ramping up that quickly. So they have to latch on to the good ones right away, I think. So
flexibility is a good word for a value, that's for sure.
Yeah, for sure. and you know, we're going to send everybody an email that has like the links for his worksheets and Will's worksheets and his book. He's available if you guys ever want to, like, you know, connect with him for any of your company stuff. And I know Will too through our EO organization. So he trains budding entrepreneurs all over the world. Is it fair to say? I know the country, yeah, but around a lot. So he has an incredible amount of experience when it comes to analyzing businesses and just getting to the root of what it is. And that's why I had asked him to come in here today to work with you guys on this stuff. So. Super interesting. So thank you.
Thank you, Ross. And thank you to all of you guys.